We're just waiting for the links and the production of the webcast to be ready to start. So please, let's just give it 1 second. I still don't see the link ready. Right. Shall we start then? Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Pablo Hinojosa. I work for APNIC, the Regional Internet Registry for Asia Pacific. We have been working on security related issues, particularly in the context of capacity building for our membership and wider technical community. These are the people who are actually building and maintaining ISPs and other network infrastructure services. Thanks mostly to Duncan and Madeline, we spotted an opportunity and together we submitted a workshop proposal that successfully made it here to the IGF. It's a little bit out of our comfort zone in the technical arena, but we look forward to learn from you, and I hope that we can have a useful dialogue and discussion. So welcome all to the Cyber Moms meeting Internet Governance. I don't know if you saw the transcript. They transcribed cyber norms into cyber moms. So welcome all the cyber moms here. What are we trying to do here is to facilitate an introduction between two fields that have not met quite yet formally. And can I risk to say they have not been properly introduced. They have heard of each other in the corridors here and there. They have coincided in the same rooms in different occasions. But the idea here is to give a warm welcome to a few friends to the IGF. Our friends come from the international law and international relations fields. They work in think tanks, academia, governments, and have been working for many years on subjects around information security and cybersecurity. Their approach to these subjects has been around protecting national security from attacks that could disrupt critical infrastructures. They think about national security having in mind mostly attackers being foreign state actors. I will run the risk of oversimplification, but I hope that during the session, a more complete picture and understanding can occur. The first simplification is that we call this field, the cyber norms field. And to the best of my understanding, the cyber norms community trusts or aspires to a global set of enforceable rules that can be written, agreed, and that can be made effective. I'm talking about international treaties, UN, and other multilateral agreements. On the other side of the fence, actually, on this side of the fence, because we are in the IGF, right, is the Internet governance community. With its multiple stakeholders, this community believe in a decision-making model which is inclusive and where different stakeholders can participate. Another way to see this meetup opportunity is to refer to the United Nations system. The cyber norms community has operated in the context of the first committee of the United Nations. And the first committee deals with disarmament and international security. They discuss global challenges and threats to peace. Such is the case of the work being made by the government group of experts that is currently working hard in the next phase of recommendations. In contrast, the internet governance community has lived mostly in the area of the second committee of the UN Economic and Financial Issues. That is where the UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs is from, very much related to where the WSIS and the IGF derive from. Again, in a very simplistic and reductionist way, this workshop is like opening a window, perhaps just drilling a small hole between the first and the second committee is a hole big enough in order to extend the hand to the other side and promote a handshake between these two sides. A handshake between different approaches, different topics, but similar agendas and issues that, when decisions are being made, may affect one another. I would like to ask Marilia Maciel if she could be the one offering the first welcoming thoughts from the internet governance side to our dear guests from the CyberNorms community. Marilia is the digital policy senior researcher for Diplo Foundation. And we really need someone that can synthesize and make an internet governance overview in machine-gun fashion, but with laser-guided precision. So off to you, Marilia.
Thank you very much, Pablo. You should have warned me that I sat on the wrong side of the fence here, but I just started to cross-pollinize maybe the discussion.
There is no right, wrong, or right sides of the fence.
Point well taken. But I thought about to start a discussion from an internet governance standpoint, mentioning some of the characteristics of the internet governance discussions that may facilitate or may pose some obstacles for the bridging of this gap to take place. Although security was a concern that was pretty much there when the internet was created, after all, the internet was a military project, this project broke free from the military realm and developed quite a set of specific characteristics. So the internet was further developed by the technical and academic communities, which has a very specific ethos and principles and beliefs that guide the way that they operate. And these beliefs got somehow enmeshed into the architecture of the internet. We are talking about, for instance, openness, the principle of permissionless innovation, the end-to-end design, the design of the some of the internet protocols that we have today that in the future would pose a problem to attribution. But when the internet was created, security was not necessarily on the mindset of those that were developing the architecture of the internet. And this is something that we need to take into account when we try to bridge this gap. A second characteristic is that in internet governance, states were very much latecomers into the process. So when they started to understand the importance of discussing internet and internet governance and organized the first world summit on the internet on the information society, many commercial actors were already operating on the internet. So we already had Amazon, we already had Google, and it's very hard to put the genie back into the bottle. The fact that states were not there does not mean that the internet was not being regulated. There was rules of the game that were pretty much already in place when states arrived. Most of the rules of the game are still defined by private actors. So if we look at the infrastructure layer, we see that contractual agreements of transit, of peering, pretty much define how this infrastructure operates. If we look at ICANN, for instance, or the logic layer, we see that the contracts between ICANN and registrars that define the way that this layer is governed. And if we look at the layer in which we feel and experience the internet, the layer of applications, we all accept terms of service that we usually do not read, but we go and we accept, and these terms of service are pretty much the norm that govern our presence online. This is a very different approach when we think about international relations, when we think about security, in which international agreements play a much more prominent role. What the WSIS did when it took place was to recognize these actors that inhabited before the internet governance landscape. And the WSIS text provides a base for multi-stakeholder operation and in internet governance. And if we look at the security field, we are very much far away from having a full multi-stakeholder adoption or even understanding. But multi-stakeholderism has evolved throughout the years. And I think that from the start, we had a very strict concept of multi-stakeholder participation. We thought that all the actors were exactly the same and they should be on equal footing in every discussion and every step of the discussion. And I think that this understanding has been somewhat refined throughout the years. And we see that documents, more recent ones, like the outcome document of Net Mundial, asks for a clarification of the different roles and responsibilities that different actors have in internet governance. And one of the examples that is usually given is security. It's not that discussions about security should not be held in a multi-stakeholder fashion, they should, but actors have different responsibilities and this needs to be recognized. And I think that this creates a good opportunity for us to discuss with actors that deal with security. And on the other side, I feel more and more that actors dealing with security are open to acknowledge and to understand the importance of non-governmental actors in this ecosystem. They cannot operate national security policies and defense policies if they do not talk to the private sector, if they do not talk to CISRTs, if they do not reach out to civil society, because after all, sometimes the weakest link to security issues is on the end user, is on the person that has malware on his or her computer, that deploys botnet, DDoS attacks without knowing in this part of a botnet. So lastly, I think that one stark difference between the two fields is that the WSIS documents put individual at the center of every internet governance discussions. Discussions should be people-centered and development-oriented. And this view has been not only endorsed, but even strengthened when information society and the sustainable development goals started to be discussed together recently. So the individual is at the center. When we see security discussions, the state is at the center. In national security, policies protect many times the existence of the state, not necessarily its people. So maybe it's time, I think, for the security side also to rethink where they place the individual in security discussions, and that would certainly create more place for bridging the gap. Thanks.
Marilia, thanks to you. On behalf of the CyberNorm side, I would like to introduce Duncan Hollis, who actually is the co-organizer of this session. He's actually the brain power behind the proposal we sent to the MAG in June and the force of inspiration for this to happen. Duncan, could you please provide us with an overview of the CyberNorm space? What is it? Where does it come from? Where is it going? For the record, sorry, Duncan is a professor of law at Temple University, and I think we should be very thankful to you for joining us here in the IGF.
All right. Thank you, Pablo, for bringing me to my first IGF. And if you'll be patient with me, I want to start off by asking a very different question, which is, what are you wearing today? Like, think about what you're wearing. And as I look around, as it befits a multi-stakeholder event, we're all seeing lots of different fashion choices. So the question is, why are you wearing what you're wearing? I, for example, am wearing a jacket with no tie because I was told that is appropriate attire for the IGF. And obviously, looking around the room, there's a fairly broad band of what's appropriate, but I don't see any bathing suits. I don't see any tuxedos. And I guess the reason is although we say we dress for the occasion, right, that we have norms that are cueing us as to what the appropriate behavior is. Norms are collective expectations of proper behavior by members of a group. And we have all sorts of communities that form groups, whether it's the IGF as a community, whether it's engineers as a community, lawyers, or institutions like CERTs, or say members of the NRO. The community, I think, that Pablo invited me to talk about here today is the community of sovereign states and their norms for cybersecurity. And I should say, kind of having Maria's historical perspective, that when we look at how states as a community have addressed cybersecurity issues, they didn't start with a GGE or the United Nations. They started domestically. They started with regulating cybercrime and intellectual property at a domestic level. And it wasn't until 1998 when Russia came to the United Nations with this idea that information could be weaponized, suggesting that in some ways what needed to happen was some sort of arms control approach, and indeed a treaty on information weapons. The idea, I should say, got a very cool reception. Only a few states supported it. But what came out of that was an agreement at the United Nations to set up what we call the GGE, the Group of Government Experts. Fast forward to today, 2016, and we're in the midst of our, I believe some GGE members are here so they can correct me. I think this is the fifth, and it's scheduled to finish in 2017, and it will hopefully build on the work of the two prior GGE reports issued in 2013 and 2015. The 2015 GGE was notable for the 20 member states agreeing on a suite of voluntary, non-binding information security norms for responsible state behavior in peacetime. And the substance of those proposals, and we may get a chance to discuss them, are pretty interesting. States should not target critical infrastructure. States should avoid using proxies. States should not use certs as targets or tools for cyber operations. Or an idea near and dear to my own heart, I pushed a duty to assist victims of cyber operations. Equally of interest is, what's the new GGE going to do? Will it have some norms on encryption? Will it propose that states agree to protect what's called the public core of the internet, according to the Dutch? But for me, I think that there are actually at least three aspects of the GGE process that are as important as the content of the norms that they are promoting. And that's the scope, their voluntary nature, and their emergence from a multilateral process. So quickly, in terms of scope, I think it's important to understand, as was already noted, is the GGE is coming out of the first committee of the United Nations, which deals with arms control and international peace and security. That means that whatever the GGE does, it's going to be cabined by those subjects. So the GGE is not going to address cyber threats in the form of cybercrime, even if attribution problems sometimes make it difficult for victims to know, are they being a victim of an individual attack or a state-sponsored one? But even within the security context, the question of what the GGE is supposed to focus on is still up for grabs. We might simplify this as a debate between the information security people and the cybersecurity people. Do you focus on just, you know, norms for protecting confidentiality losses, integrity losses, and availability losses? Or do you extend beyond that cybersecurity to information security and want to have controls on speech, subversive or otherwise? Beyond the scope, it's also important to emphasize that what the GGE has been advancing are voluntary, non-binding norms. That's not to say the GGE has not focused on international law, and indeed the GGE is to be commended for actually agreeing in 2013 and 2015 that international law applies in cyberspace. But the question for the GGE then became, well, how does it apply? And at least what I'm hearing is that they're having great difficulty in articulating more specific rules on things like cyber war or state operations that don't rise to a cyber war level. And it's those difficulties, I think, that led the GGE to this idea of norms. And maybe we can talk a bit more later about how one operationalizes them, but that's kind of where they're moving, is this idea that maybe we can have a socially constructed set of behaviors that guide behavior, much like how we decide what to wear and we avoid wearing bathing suits in this room. My final point, and probably the one that probably strikes a chord or maybe a hostile one with the IGF, is the structure of the GGE. It is undeniably state-centric. Today, it is 25 states negotiating over norms for states. Now, there are occasional nods to multi-stakeholderism, and I would say, if we have time, to talk about how the GGE has become more inclusive, but be clear that whatever they negotiate is going to be done as a final text behind closed doors, old-style diplomacy. That said, let me end on a slightly more positive note. Just because the formation of what the GGE norms are does not mean that multi-stakeholderism will be excluded from the process entirely. We might envision a more multi-stakeholder approach to the operationalizing of these norms, to monitoring whether states follow through with what they say they're going to do, and also figure out ways to build capacity, technical assistance, and the like. Lots more to say about this. I look forward to the conversation, but I'll stop here for now.
Duncan Henry. Sorry, Duncan, can I take my jacket off almost? We're also very fortunate to have here with us Henry Rigas. He's a policy researcher at the NATO Cooperative Cyber Defense Center of Excellence. Henry, welcome to the IGF, welcome to Mexico. You work very closely on research about state-to-state offensive cyber operations, and you may want to add a bit about what Duncan just said, so please go ahead.
Thank you. First of all, thank you, Pablo and Duncan, for putting together this workshop. I think you have really identified an area where certain communities have been in their own silos. So let's see whether we can break those barriers. And with that in mind, and since this is a session that aims to open the discussion, I will also initially just outline some of the main characteristics of and dynamics of the ongoing cyber norms processes. And I hope this provides a basis for further discussions on states, on how states and other stakeholders can collaborate. As pointed out by Duncan, the debate has on cyber norms has so far been mostly between governments, be it in the UN First Committee, but also in the OSCE, and also on a bilateral basis. And I think it would be useful to first explain what is meant in these forums by the term cyber norms. Because the term norm, essentially, as Duncan also presented, cover a very wide area of activities and influence a very wide area of actors. And if we apply the definition, which is very well accepted in the academic community, that norm is a standard of appropriate behavior for actors with a given identity, then this implies that the norm can substantially differ in terms of legal bindingness or have political characters, technical characters, or ethical characteristics. And in my view, a lack of clarity on the term causes confusion and limits progress in these more multilateral discussions. And if we look at the current cyber norms related developments in the context of international security, the focus has been mainly on international norms that aim to regulate state behavior with regard to offensive cyber operations. And these discussions have been influenced most by the interests of major powers that have high level cyber capabilities. In other words, it's the discussion is between actors that actually might conduct those significant offensive operations against each other. And I think it's an important point. And we can observe progress with two types of norms. First, politically binding and legally binding norms. In the context of legally binding norms, as Duncan mentioned, UNGG and the international community has accepted or acknowledged the very basic but significant notion that international law applies to state activities in cyberspace. However, states are not really clarified how does international law applies, and I think here's one way that non-state actors can actually provide valuable input. For example, in the CCDCOE, we have hosted the Tallinn Manual process, which gathers legal scholars to address this exact issue. We published the first Tallinn Manual in 2013. It focused on how the law of armed conflict applies to cyber activities. And now, in the beginning of next year, we'll publish Tallinn Manual 2.0, which focuses on the peacetime level activities. And I think the academia's input here is valuable also for the states, because these discussions can be more flexible and actually provide valuable input to the two states, and states have been more actively engaged in the Tallinn Manual process. And in addition to those legal norms, we have those politically binding norms which Duncan mentioned. And perhaps the most prominent here are the norms of responsible behavior, which is promoted by the UNGG in the last 2015 report, which identified certain targets which should not be attacked, for example, search or critical infrastructure. And these norms are made to apply during peacetime, which is an important aspect, I think. And the OSCE has developed these things called confidence building measures, two set of those, which aim to mainly establish very basic information exchange channels. It is important to keep in mind that with those political binding norms, these are not certainly new legal instruments. They are rather, as I said, confidence building measures, additional layers to this normative framework. And these instruments aim usually or very often to prevent miscalculation and interstate conflict escalation by establishing those communication mechanisms and identifying areas or targets which should not be attacked. But here we also can see a similar progress as with the legally binding norms. We see that certain non-state actors have realized that they also have a stake in this. Most prominently, the private sector has been providing their input. For example, Microsoft has proposed a set of those politically binding norms. But nevertheless, although we can see non-state actors being more involved, I like the point which is important for our workshop, I think. As you said, most of these discussions are still dominated by governments, since they are held in a so-called geopolitical or international security context. And thus the discussions tend to be dominated by different and often opposing state interests. And as these forums address very highly sensitive clandestine activities that are of national security or military relevance. And before I stop, I'd like to introduce you a book which actually focuses on this topic, which we launched this year. It's called International Cyber Norms, Legal Policy and Industry Perspectives, which provides a good introduction for actually this community as well about the main processes in this area. And this can be accessed on our website for free at ccdcoe.org. I'll stop here.
Thank you, Henry, for setting the scene. And I would like to invite Alejandro Pisanti to sort of wrap up sort of this initial part of the session with your views on internet governance. I know your weapon of choice, Alex, has always been the strength of the internet principles. And when you see Alex speaking about these principles, they really seem impossible to hack, bend, or break.
But they are resilient. So good afternoon, my name is Alejandro Pisanti. I work at the National University of Mexico and I am the chair of the Internet Society chapter in Mexico. Thank you for the signal, Paul. So number one, this is the first batch of identification of the internet governance side of this gap. I may be wrong, I'm permanent beta. Every statement has to be tested and may be corrected. I have had the unique opportunity of engaging in dialogue with the cyber norms community, thanks to a man who should be here next year. We must bring him, who's called Ron Diebert, who runs he's the head of the Citizen Lab in the University of Toronto. He really bridges this gap like few others. And thanks to that, I have had the chance to meet Henry, Duncan, and many others, very distinguished scholars in that field. I think that I'm going to add on the description that Marilia has made of the internet governance side. I'm afraid to say that with some strong divergence from the description. First, it's an urban legend that security was not considered in the design of the internet. That statement is a lie. The security available to the computer scientists, physicists, coders, engineers that first designed the internet protocols was the best available in their time. It was computer security. It was security for the mainframes in which they ran simulation, I mean in which not they, but in which simulations of nuclear bombs were run. It was the security of computers where the whole payroll of the United States government or of IBM or of several other large corporations was run, where their intellectual property was held. These were the best protected computers in the planet, or at least they were at the same level, and the other ones would have been in Russia, probably. So it was the highest level of security ever available till that age. What they did decide was not to put security in the hands of the network. They decided to keep the security in the edge. They decided to keep the security at the highest level that computers could evolve in the edge, whereas if they decided to put encryption or passwords or anything else in the gear inside the network, they would have to be replacing the equipment and the software inside the network every time a small amount of computer power increase was available. So they would need to replace the whole network. So they said the critical assets will be protected at the edge, and we will work with the best security that we can buy as time goes by for the network equipment. This is a very, very, very important statement to dispel, because it shows you how this philosophy has evolved. It has become necessary to protect the network. It has become necessary to make the network a bit smarter in order to protect the network assets themselves. That's taking a great expense, and it also has an expense in keeping it open and interoperable while secure. This is not easy. These are design constraints that people have to take very seriously. So sorry, Pablo, to fit your urban legend that I take care about the principles. That's the way they work. That's the way you bring them to bear. Second, indeed, ICANN, for example, has been built on a set of private agreements that are purely based on private law. But the internet was not built on contracts and formal agreements. It has been said again and again, most lately, I think, by Andrew Sullivan, the internet runs on a handshake. The internet runs on the basis of very informal but very trustworthy informal agreements between the different parties. And these agreements don't have a contract, because today it may be I'm passing your packets to someone else whom I'm not interested or who even is against me. Tomorrow it may be I'm stopping those packets because those packets are hurting someone, again, without seeing if I am interested or not. And from passing the packets on, filtering the packets, making charging agreements or making peering agreements by realizing that charging is not practical when the differences are going to be smaller than the cost of charging, than the cost of the accounting. From then on, IXPs, all these huge structures we're speaking about now, all of this was built on trust. And the internet has been so well designed that even by after being based on trust in its design, it has been able to survive in an environment where trust is not anymore an assumption. The internet, the access to internet governance, again, is very important. I will address the multi-stakeholder point already made by Marilia here in a way that I think cuts a bit deeper. We people working on or for or with the internet in developing countries were able to work together with the other people that were making the internet, creating and expanding the internet. Because we agreed to work with them, we went to internet societies, workshops to be trained or sent people to be trained without asking the government for a network that was under the government's radars in developing or in authoritarian countries. So we worked across stakeholders. Some of us were working, or some of my predecessors, I'm not ascribing myself this heroic role, this is a generation before mine. My predecessors worked, some of them in government units, some of them were in government laboratories, some of them were in the National Science Councils, some of them were in companies, some of them were in NGOs, and they all came together just because they had to pass packets to each other and they had to learn how to pass those packets. So that cooperation across different stakeholder groups is organic to the growth of the internet. And that's what the openness of the internet means above the purely technical level. When ICANN was built, it was built on an identification of who were the possible stakeholders for the domain name system, the IP addresses, and the internet protocols. And a few years later, one can say this anecdotically, WSIS happened because the government, or especially WGIG and IGF, these other specific internet governance parts of the World Summit of the Information Society, happened because, and the word multi-stakeholder arose in that context because the governments asked for a seat on that table. They had their seats. They could have just taken them. There was no one impeding their access. It was just they hadn't decided to sit there. They had decided to sit behind closed doors and smoke-filled rooms, negotiating text, which is 7 words of difference for 2 weeks, and like in the recent WTSA. So that's the origin of this multi-stakeholder. There's Here is another urban legend I would like to deflate, and I'm close to closing. There's an urban legend that says that the internet community claims that there has to be absolutely equal representation between all four stakeholder groups in every possible mechanism, and that there's like a one-size-fits-all kind of approach. And this is another urban legend that has to be dispelled. Multi-stakeholder cooperation is done on the internet by in the same way that the internet is done. Form follows function. What do you need? Do you need to stop spam from one ISP to another? The ISP technicians talk to the other ISP's technicians, and that's for a definition of spam. What are the names or the IP addresses or the reputation filters you're using? You block it. It's an engineer-to-engineer thing. You have problems with intellectual property, you will bring in the IP lawyers. You have problems with regulations, you'll bring your regulatory lawyers. You bring who you need. You solve the problem. You don't create a structure and then look for problems. You have the problem, you look for a solution, and you make sure every party involved is adequately involved. So for law enforcement purposes, of course you're going to be bringing, or let's say, attacks that have law enforcement implications. Of course you're going to bring in the police, and you're going to bring in the best and the most authoritative police that you need to solve this problem. So there, that's another myth that goes away. And that is probably my statement here. And about the view of cyber norms from the net governance side, I'll be very brief. It is very important to recognize what we see every day, what people see. I'm speaking on behalf of people who have not asked me to do so. I hope I'm not wrong, totally. Non-state actors are the everyday, are the 99%, and sometimes the 100% of what you see that looks like an attack, or a scan before of an attack, like people are looking for open ports to see what they can attack. All of this comes from non-state actors. They may be fostered by state actors or by states, but you don't know. You see the packets, you see the IP address. Maybe you see something more, but you don't see the state, even if the state is paying these provocateurs. So it's very important also to be able to solve the attribution problem. That, in the technical community, is seen as a very long shot. And on the other hand, cyber norms will be welcome. They are very high away, very, very far up in the upper layers of the internet. But they could be very useful if they gave the CERT people, for example, the designers or the operators, clear guidelines. What is a malicious attack? Do you define a malicious attack by, or let's say a sovereignty attack by scanning ports? Then I have to report that to the national security authorities. If it's only a public security suspicious violation, then I will report it to the police. If it's a trivial activity that has only to be reported in the aftermath of an attack, then we'll keep it in a file and use it, or set us a requirement that we need to make a report once a month, give us the money for the disk, and we'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilia, Duncan, Henry, Alex, for setting the scene. I think you have, I was thinking that you have successfully explained two pillars, but now I think there are actually four pillars. I was trying to build an arc here, but then we have mostly like four different conceptions of these issues, and we need to lay a roof on top of that. We have norms as private contracts, we have norms for state responsible behavior, we have fashion norms, we have norms of participation in different forums, we have norms of configuration of mainframes and network computers. So we have norms everywhere, and Henry insisted a lot, well, let's define this very well, and what is it, the realm that we are talking about? So I would like to suggest to sort of peel the onion and put the roof on this solid basis. I would like to open the discussion at this stage in terms of sort of the views of the floor and perhaps some remote participants if they would like to contribute to the discussion. Please, it has been a great surprise to learn that one of the members of the UN government group of experts is here with us. If I only could have known, we should have included in the preparatory process. Welcome. set your name and sure.
Thank you and good afternoon. My name is Michael Wama. I'm the Cyber Foreign Policy Coordinator for the Foreign Affairs Department of the Canadian government. I am the Canadian expert to the UN Group of Governmental Experts, and as well, I was the Canadian expert in the 2012-2013 edition of the GGE. But I feel like I sit on both sides of the fence because I was also the Canadian chief negotiator of the WSIS Plus 10, where Canada was among those pushing very strongly for an open, free, and secure internet based on a multi-stakeholder approach to internet governance in the, certainly with a great deal of opposition from some places around the table. So I do feel a little bit like I can actually perhaps bridge that gap a little bit, as I do believe that I sit on both sides of the fence. If I may, I can speak for Canada, but I can't speak for others. So with that caveat, let me speak just a little bit about how we see this GGE process. And let me start off by saying that I agree with a lot of what I've heard here today, though I would offer a couple of precisions with respect to a few things. First off, the UN GGE, it is a bit of a polite fiction, but the experts, according to the resolution, serve as in an individual capacity. They are not, in fact, meant to, or formally meant to be representative of government in those negotiations. But that is a polite fiction. I mean, frankly, it is a state-to-state negotiation. I would also add that what the GGE produces, when it produces it, is a report. And the report can contain recommendations, but they are only recommendations. And they're not binding on anybody, including the governments that were represented in the group. That report is then submitted to the Secretary General of the United Nations, which then passes it on to the First Committee of the General Assembly. So just with that slight sort of clarification. So as I said, I can speak for Canada, but I can't speak for other countries. And of course, given the nature of the negotiation that's taking place, there are limitations about what I would be able to say about the actual ongoing negotiation, because that is the conditions that we agree to when we undertake the negotiations. So Canada's overall goal in participating in the Group of Governmental Experts is to contribute to strategic stability in cyberspace. That is, we are seeking to avoid interstate conflict in cyberspace, as Duncan has said. And I think most would agree, given recent events, that is a real issue, an important issue, and one that needs addressing. But I think the key point there, and this is one that Duncan made, is the whole question of cabining, if you will. So this is a creature of the First Committee of the General Assembly, and as Duncan said, it deals with states and it deals with questions of international security. So Canada is insisting within the GGE negotiations that we limit the discussion there to focus explicitly on those, on state behavior and on international security. And when I say international security, I mean international security is understood in the traditional diplomatic sense. That is interstate conflict, the avoidance of interstate conflict. And I think it's really important to recognize that certainly on the part of Canada and others, we are being absolutely adamant that this is the limitation to the discussion that we are having in this space. There have been proposals by some to move into other related questions, or unrelated in our view questions. Things related to, for example, cybercrime, terrorist use of the internet, even internet governance. And we have adamantly opposed efforts to broaden that discussion because that is not the appropriate forum for those discussions. We do have other places, multi-stakeholder places, where these issues are being discussed. And as I say, from our perspective, what we want to focus on is something that I think is essential to the interests of sovereign states, and that is the questions related to state behavior with the goal of avoiding state conflict in this space. So that, in very general terms, is where we're coming from this, and perhaps a bit of an explanation of, you know, where we come across on the approach with respect to states. I would say as well that, you know, there are exercises underway to be more transparent and more open about this process. We're here. We're talking about it here. There have been reports published. There have been, the reports themselves are available on the UN website. There have been a number of academic and other conferences devoted to the question. Many of these have participation from UNGGE states, so as to allow for that dialogue between states and non-state actors, whether they be NGOs, academic, or the private sector. So I would say that, you know, there is an effort, certainly, to make sure that there is a degree of transparency and openness about this. But I would add that there are limits to what will happen in that space. Sorry, I'm trying to look down the table at the same time. We are bound, as governments, by the Westphalian model of sovereign states, with an international legal order which is based on the sovereign equality of states and that relationship. The UN is founded on those principles. The activities of the UN are based on those principles. And we are constrained to respect those principles in these negotiations. There are states that absolutely insist on that. And if we are to have these discussions, then we are going to have to, in a sense, allow ourselves to be constrained by that system. Because if we didn't, these discussions wouldn't take place. And I think that's a very bad outcome. I'll stop there, but I'm happy to speak or answer any questions that anyone might have. Thanks.
I will take them a little bit later. I am looking at them, but this is from the remote participation. Let's see, how do we take this? perhaps, Irene, I would ask you to come with some remarks. You have been kind of in both sides, and I would like to hear your views on how to bridge these sort of security discussions with internet governance discussions as well, if there is at all a chance, in your opinion. You know, Irene is researcher and communications officer with the Citizen Lab at the University of Toronto.
Thank you, Pablo, and to Duncan for convening this really interesting panel, and to all of you for joining us this afternoon. So as Pablo said, my name is Irene, and I work with the Citizen Lab at the University of Toronto. And for those of you who are not familiar, the Citizen Lab conducts research on cybersecurity and human rights, such as the impact of censorship, filtering, and surveillance, targeted digital attacks against civil society groups, telecommunications transparency and accountability, among other things. So I'm not sure if I can bridge the gap, but I will raise a few brief points, and I look forward to continuing the discussions. As you said, Pablo, earlier, that there are norms everywhere, but I would like to point out that there has been a lot of attention paid on good norms, such as, and by that I mean norms that we would like to see, as opposed to norms that exist, or bad or threatening norms, at least from the point of view of the liberal democratic tradition, and these norms are spreading. Therefore, I would like to highlight that it is important to study norms that are undemocratic, such as norms of unaccountability, and practices such as internet censorship and shutdowns, and how they spread from one country to another. And I think that we also need to look at the different venues in which norms are being discussed and propagated, not just global ones like that the UN convene or the ITU, but also regional ones like the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the SCO, and ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. And the second point that I'd like to make is that in our research on targeted digital threats against civil society groups, we find that civil society groups, especially those in the global south, they face the same kind of cyber attacks that Fortune 500 companies and governments face, but they have less resources available to counter them. And we published this finding recently in a report called Communities at Risk, Targeted Digital Threats Against Civil Society, which is available online at targetedthreats.net. And therefore, I think it's important that civil society are included in the discussions. So I'll end there for now. Thank you.
I think two questions that were pasted in the chat of the remote participation platform. While focused on states, actors work through privately owned infrastructure, and any state action spill over, for example, the YouTube case in Pakistan. And another question from Vladimir, he says, well, how about norms that apply to the private sector and the internet industry, which goes a bit into what you're saying. And what's the role of the IGF in all of this, I think, is an important question as well to refer to. The floor is open, but I would like sort of also this side of the room to contribute. Izumi, would you like to go ahead? Okay. Izumi Okutani, she is a policy officer of the Japan JPNIC, Japan Network Information Center. Thank you for being here.
Hello, everyone. Very interesting to see the other side of the perspective, because I'm more involved in what we call the technical community and number resources community in particular, where many operators and other stakeholders participate. So I'd like to share an example of how we solve problems in the technical community, just to highlight the difference on how things are done. I'm not necessarily saying that, you know, you should exactly do it in the same way for cybersecurity norms for states, but you know, I just want to highlight the difference, and I'd like to also list an example of the norms that exist in the operational communities. And really agree with Alexandro's statement that a lot of the things that's being done in the technical community is very much based on grassroots open collaboration. So when we actually face cybersecurity problems like DDoS attacks, I'd like to share one example which highlights how we actually do it. So a couple of years ago, there was an attack, DDoS attack based on NTP reflection attacks. That's, it might sound a bit technical, but in any case, it was quite huge and getting a bit of attention in different parts of the world. And then there was a presentation made in the conference in the APNIC region, and it highlighted which countries has a lot of equipment that has vulnerabilities to those attacks. And then Japan was in like the top of the list. And a Japanese operator saw this, and they were so embarrassed that Japan was on the top of the list. So they just came back to their operational community. We have this JANOG, the Japan Network Operators Group. They updated this. And then operators started discussing how can we do, what can we actually go do together to help this problem. And so what they've done is discuss what are those things that operators can do together, and they actually put it up in a document, and so that as a guidance for the operators on what they can do. And as a result of that, the rate of the vulnerability in the NTP server from Japan drastically decrease. We couldn't make it totally to zero, because there were areas where consumers had to address, and there was limitation on what ISPs can do. So this is actually a good example where multi-stakeholder collaboration could actually help. So this was actually what happened, an example of how we actually work in the operational communities. I also want to state that we do have norms among the operators as well. So we develop documents called the best current practices documents in different fields. And there's actually one on the area of security called mutually agreed norms and routing security. And this again is developed in bottom-up way. Anyone is able to provide input, and the document is publicly available. And so it's very much conducted in an open way. What's common with the norms that was described earlier is it's voluntary, and so it's not compulsory, and it's written in a way that would encourage certain measures or behavior. So I think there's a commonality in there, but what might be different is participation in developing it is open to anyone. And I think it was interesting on a point that Duncan made, that maybe so after cyber norms are developed between the states, there are ways on how to operationalize it. And you know, maybe there's a room for other people to participate in terms of operationalizing it. And we actually collaborate with other stakeholders in the RIR community as well. For example, in the area of increasing WHO's accuracy, we're actually working together with the law enforcement agencies on how they can actually have more accurate information in identifying the holder of IP address, which to understand the source of attack or the victim. And so how we can work this together to increase public safety. So there's open discussions going to happen in spring next year. And so this will be actually a collaboration of law enforcement agencies with the operational communities in open and bottom-up manner. So just highlighting some of the examples.
I have Paul Wilson and then Felix. Paul is the Director General of APNIC and a recent addition to the advisory board. And then you, is that okay?
Thank you, Pablo. Yes, I'm involved with the GFCE as a member of the advisory board because the GFCE started as a kind of pretty straight public-private partnership. But I guess it was realized a little later that that at least some part of the multi-stakeholder community was missing, the civil society as they called it, but that happens in their terms to include the technical community. I'm fine with that actually. But I do, the thing is, I do actually spend more of my time on the internet governance side of this table. I know Izumi Okutani very well, for instance. But I am happy to be here. My interest is to help to make sure that in these discussions, to be sure that the norms that are being talked about at any level are being operationalized in consideration of the effects and the side effects that they may have. And that's something that can require a multi-stakeholder approach. Thing is, in the middle of these discussions about internet governance and cyber norms, sometimes the subject of those discussions and the target of those discussions is something actually much more concrete. It's the technical infrastructure of the internet itself, the thing that we rely on. And that's a baby that we need to look after and not throw out with the bathwater. Not only not throw it out with the bathwater, but make sure that it is maintained and grown and protected in order that it can do what we actually all expect it to do for us as its life goes on. Because, I mean, many policy decisions can have consequences at this technical and operational level. And so those decisions do need to be well considered, particularly, again, by the technical community in terms of these people being those who live with the day-to-day operation of the network, sort of at the coalface, if you like. And there's a lot of work that goes into making sure that internet services are maintained and built and secured in a way that that we all expect, but we actually take for granted. So the whole situation of a need for expert input isn't unique to the internet as an infrastructure. It's the same thing that exists in all sorts of other sectors. But I mention it here because this is what the IGF is all about. And even here, I sort of see an assumption, as I said, that the internet can be taken for granted, that services kind of happen for free, almost automatically, off the shelf, if you like. So for me being here and having spent time and spending time on both sides of the table, it's about capacity building to make sure that the people who are charged with the responsibility to maintain the structure, to build it, to develop the standards, the technical community in general actually do have a say and have the ability to influence and to bring some experience to bear, as well at the same time to understand the information flow in the other direction, so that we are also aware of expectations as they are emerging. But I mean, the simple message is that the difference between a secure internet and an insecure internet has actually got more to do with the skills and capacities of the people who are running that and building that and maintaining it than almost anything else, and that's human capacity. So that's why I'm actually very happy to be with the GFCE, because it is about capacity building. Actually, that's explicitly what its mission is. It's about cooperative initiatives with a public-private dimension, and hopefully the other stakeholders, the civil society and technical community, will be in the room eventually, even if not just yet. Thanks.
Juan Fernandez from the government of Cuba.
Yes, my name is Juan Fernandez. I'm from the Ministry of Communication of Cuba. Cuba is one of the 25 countries currently on the GGE. And I'm not the expert, but the expert is from my ministry, and we created a group there. I work in closely with him. And I am in the liberty, I'm not in the liberty of telling everything of the negotiation, how it's going, but I'm in the liberty of telling you that Cuba is one of the countries that defends the linkage between the internet governance community and the process of the GGE. But as Mr. Walma just said, that view is not widely shared in the GGE, so it's premature to see how this will unfold. But I think that it's a bit ambitious to begin this linkage by the norm, because it's not even clear in the GGE if the norms will be accepted, or even the more, benign, confidence-building measures that are being tabled on the GGE, that we will have to wait to see how this unfolds. But definitely what I could defend here is that definitely there's some linkage, because the cyber internet is the same space in a way. So I think that we should investigate, try to find the common ground where this relationship could build on. And I don't know the opinion of Mr. Walma, but I think that one that could be a sort to work is terminology. I think that the terminology, that is one of the processes that is going on even within the GGE, I think that's a thing that could be done in a shared way with the IGF community, because I think that to understand the terms that have the same conceptions of terms, because there are many terms that we take for granted and are interpreted very differently by different countries. And I don't know if you're aware of this work by the East-West Institute of Russia and United States. They're doing interesting agreements in terminology. I think this should be shared also to the internet governance community and help to try to create a common terminology. I think that it could be a contribution. Again, I would like to hear Mr. Walma's opinion on this. And also, I think that there are many other things, as was mentioned by Irene, that there are some other contributions on the table by the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, by the OCDE, that are being advanced at different places, and it makes no harm for the IGF community to know about those processes and to begin not to only to understand but to have an opinion surrounding that. Because in my personal opinion, and now I say a personal opinion, I'm not one to anticipate anything on the GGE, I think that whatever comes out of the GGE in terms of confidence building measures and norms will not be very widely from those proposals already tabled by OCDE and Russia and the SCO. So I think that it's good that could be the beginning, and then see how things unfold.
Thank you, Juan. We will need to press the accelerator. I have a few speakers on board: Matthew, Anya, Henry, Marilia, Duncan. We only have 20 minutes, so let's do it.
Thanks. This conversation is really interesting
full,
because I think.
Full name?
Matthew Scheer, Center for Democracy and Technology. This conversation is really interesting because I think it exemplifies the problem that we face in this space. On the one hand, and I'm not meaning to insult anybody here, but on the one hand, we have part of the panel talking about internet principles, and on the other hand, we have part of the panel talking about cyber conflict and state-on-state conflict. And yet there doesn't seem to be very much that bridges between the two right now in this discussion. So my question is, I would very much like to know from the GGE and also from the technical community, to what degree does the GGE and the government representatives who are in the GGE actually look to the technical community for inputs, for advice? And similarly, I'd like to know from the technical community how much they reach out to those representatives who might be attending or participating in the GGE. And that's where the bridging should occur. And the other point, I'll be very quick, is that if you go back to 2002 and 2003 and read the UNGA resolution on the global culture for cybersecurity, you'll note that we haven't progressed very far when you compare those original texts to the GGE report from 2015. Thanks.
Anya Kovac from the Internet Democracy Project in India.
Thank you, Pablo. Though our work is research-based, in many ways we are a typical civil society organization, and it's from that perspective that I wanted to make a few comments. I guess to provide a counterpoint to some of what has been said, and from there also to broaden the discussion a little further even, I think. The first thing is that I actually disagree with the premise. Contrary to most people around this table, it seems, I actually don't think that cybersecurity and internet governance have been all that far apart. In fact, earlier this year, we commissioned a research study, and I have a few copies here, looking at the intersection between cybersecurity and internet governance, specifically in India's foreign policy. And what we saw is actually that cybersecurity, and this is what we had expected also, had been the main driver of much of what the stances that India had taken in the internet governance arena. There are many historical reasons for that, which are documented in the report, so for reasons of time, I won't go into them. But what they did point to was that this debate is indeed part of a larger geopolitical context, as Henry was pointing out. What that then means is that you cannot just isolate a debate about cyber norms in the first committee. These are many related debates, or at least several related debates, playing out in several different venues in a core way and spilling over in many, many more venues. So while diplomatically it might seem as if they are being kept apart, from the perspective of people who are not in every single one of those rooms, they do not seem to be apart. So let me give a few examples. I think one of the big processes in which we actually saw this debate reappear again and again was the process that was mentioned earlier, the WSIS plus 10 review, where in several venues, text was consistently parked, issues were not allowed to be debated because of hang-ups around cybersecurity, so to say. For people who are not in the rooms where those core debates took place, if you do not know the background, the first time you sit in these meetings, you think, what the hell is going on here? But the influence of that debate was massive, so much so that in one of the negotiations in the ITU, at some point it looked as if the entire negotiated text might be held hostage to cybersecurity concerns, but luckily that was resolved. Another example, I guess from a different angle, is the whole jurisdiction debate, where I see law enforcement officers, people from intelligence agencies, or actually mostly law enforcement, discuss solutions on the ground, mostly from Western countries, not taking into account at all those broader geopolitical debates that are going on, and that do not sufficiently take into account often the cybersecurity concerns of developing countries. The jurisdiction debate is not going to be resolved at the ground either if those concerns aren't brought into this debate. As civil society, these are all issues we work on closely. We meet them again and again. But sadly, since, for example, the WSIS review is now completed, the number of venues where I actually get to peep into how these debates are unfolding have been reduced massively. The number of opportunities I have to speak with diplomats have reduced massively. And so as a consequence, we have far less access to how these debates are going on. So to the point, are we discussing this in the IGF? Well, I'm grateful to Pablo and Duncan for having this workshop. But when I saw the agenda for this year's IGF, I was worried and surprised how little attention there was for cybersecurity. For us, that really means even less attention, information is available. Thanks.
We have Marilia, Henry, and Duncan, and one small comment by Camino Cabana, who is the current rapporteur of the UN GGE, she is basically asking the question of whether the internet's governance community can engage with governments in any productive way to specifically support implementation of the cybersecurity norms agreed in the different GGE reports. And if not, why and how do this community at the IGF think that this kind of engagement could be facilitated? I think this is a very relevant question, and if we, in the rounding up of this discussion, can address that. So, Marilia, Henry, Duncan, and Alex, if time permits.
Thank you, Pablo. Just to quickly react to Anya's observation, because I think it's very right, and maybe what we have been characterizing as a fence that is separating us is actually bed sheets. So we are touching each other, we are pulling each other, but we are not speaking to each other, and that is maybe where we identify the gaps, but there is nothing, there is no concrete wall separating us, so we are influencing each other all the time, and that is very true. Just a quick question to the UNGG representative on attribution. I think that we touched upon this point a little bit, but we did not dig deeper into that. If you can just update on the state of discussions, it seems that there has been some outside-the-box proposals to create some sort of a clearinghouse where evidence on attribution could be taken to. That would be interesting. Just to quickly react to the first part of the debate and to what Alejandro mentioned, I think that it's unfair to say that engineers did not take security into consideration and disregarded it as a top. My idea was that they did not have a security mindset, which is something different. When they were confronted with different principles, in order to preserve principles that were important, they chose, for example, to put security in the edges, which has intelligence in the edges, which has security implications. So that was my point. And I think that in the edges, we see how lack of hygiene in the edges creates a lot of problems for security in the everyday. And with regards to your question on where this issue should be discussed, I think that one of the fora that has been increasingly more and more open, although not sufficiently open, to the participation of non-governmental actors is a global conference on cyberspace. Last time we did have an opportunity to provide some inputs, maybe we have a criticism with regards to how these inputs were taken into account, but I think that we see some breaches there, so that could be a first starting point for us to really have the commitment to mobilize respective communities to have a session like this there in the forum. Let's organize ourselves and get together and discuss.
Henry?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Just responding to your comments regarding involving private sector and technical community and how can we bridge this in general, I'd highlight this point because the current norms discussions focus on state because states actually have these capabilities to cause these significant cyber operations that would lead to escalation. So far, non-state actors actually don't have these capabilities. So these decisions are by nature made by politicians, basically, or military high-level officers. So that's why it hasn't been so inclusive. But as we're reaching in the end of our discussion, I'd just like to present perhaps a positive observation. If we look at the existing international law treaties, for example, UN Charter, prohibition on use of force, I think it's fair to say that we see that states are actually showing restraint with regard to those very high-level operations that would target, for example, critical infrastructure or cause somehow destruction or harm to people. We on a very technical level, we haven't seen attacks that would actually harm people so far. So the very, very basic international norms codified in those treaties are actually being followed. And as long as states have these capabilities, I would even say we're pretty okay. It will be stable. But if we will see non-state actors getting those capabilities, then we will definitely have a different discussion in this context.
So I guess in terms of why the conversation needs to happen, I think is stepping and looking at it from a research perspective, it does seem that there is obviously not a complete overlap, but there is some overlap between the focus although there is some debate about what the GGE should be doing and some of the things that the Internet Governance Forum, as it expands post-WSIS into other issues of internet governance, that these two processes may run parallel and cooperate. They may, at some point, reinforce each other and in preserving an open and secure and stable cyberspace, but there's also some risks that they might inadvertently or purposely conflict. And so I think one of the points of these sorts of conversations is situational awareness, that just as I think the GGE should be aware of the knock-on effects of some of the things that I think they are rightly concerned about, interstate conflict, but as we've heard, the question is, well, what are the effects of the norms, not just the interstate conflict, but the rules that we're trying to get states to follow on the technical community, on civil society, on others, and how will that iterate over time? But I also think there is a strong possibility that what happens here at the IGF offers both some, you know, maybe some problems for how the GGE could work if there's some hostility perceived between the two communities. But as I heard the Rapporteur Camino remotely suggest, there's also some potential that, that there could be a cooperation where some of the IGF stakeholders might be able to help states operationalize the sorts of norms that they're looking to develop, like not targeting critical infrastructure. Members of the IGF do a lot of monitoring. They do a lot of technical assistance. So, you know, not using certs for malicious activities, not having certs be the target of malicious activities. These are the things where this community, I think, can participate, and it might be a useful, mutually constitutive way forward. So although, again, I think they come at it from very different perspectives, and I think Henry's point is a welcome one, that the GGE's effort right now is a difficult one. We usually regulate among states after bad things happen, right? The UN system is a product of World War II, right? The Geneva Conventions are a product of World War II. And what the GGE is trying to do is, we've had some problems, but not at this global scale, right? A global shutdown, a regional shutdowns of the internet for sustained periods, not hours, but days or weeks, or corruption of the protocols and the like. And so that they are trying to do something difficult. So I do think it's worth a bit of publicity for what they're doing, because it can be hard to make norms, right? Norms can come about by habit. You don't realize why you wear the clothes you wear, but as you step back and think about it, you realize it. And so I think one of these things about situational awareness is for both the IGF community, but also the GGE, to be more conscious of why they are trying to move forward and what's motivating them. So I'll stop there.
We are running out of time, and I would like two things. One is to close this session by telling Juan and Mike one key input from here that they can take to the UNGGE. So I will leave 10 seconds to each to give that. I have Alex and Mike as the word as well. So Alex, I would ask you that you finish your comment with that input to them, and then we do very quickly around the table with that question.
Thank you, Pablo. Very briefly, I believe before we sat here, and now I believe much more strongly that we need to get to study these things together, work together. The GGE will do well in being informed about the perspectives from the internet governance side, what is uncertainties it brings to state level decisions. But that's the message for the GGE. And I think that maybe Duncan, you and I, and whoever else is on the table that's willing, we should start writing a skeleton paper on what the gaps are and how to bridge them, or how to structure a collaboration that's more like layered and fine-grained and with gears. But we definitely should not go privately, each to their side. Next meeting, we should have this gap much more narrow.
Mike.
Thank you. I'm just going to respond to some of the questions that were directed to me. On the question of terminology from Juan, my Cuban colleague.
Closer to the mic. Thanks.
Sorry. With respect to the question of terminology, that's obviously a very difficult question. When you even look at the title of the group of governmental experts,
it reflects a difference of opinion on what we're actually talking about, as some refer to information, security in the use of information, which raises the whole question of content. So that's a very hairy topic all by itself. But that said, terminology is perhaps not, at least from our perspective, the highest agenda item that we need to tackle. Matthew was asked about technical expertise and consideration. We did that internally in our own systems. We developed our processes, but I would also point out that CSIS and UNIDIR held a series of conferences in advance of the most recent launch of the GGE, which included representation from private sector and the technical community and others, academia and others, in order to get at some of those issues specifically. To Anuja's point about cybersecurity, I think the issue might be, I don't know, but I think it might be a question of definitional. As I say, from our perspective, we're using a very traditional international understanding of international security, which is interstate conflict. And we're trying to be very careful, at least from our perspective, to stay in those domains so as to preserve space in other places to talk about those broader issues. And I was also asked, I think, a little bit about attribution. Attribution is obviously a very important and difficult issue. Again, I'm kind of limited on what I can say in terms of the actual discussion at the table, but I can go so far as to say that it is certainly under active discussion. And I would point, in fact, to the previous report of the GGE, which spoke a little bit about attribution and the problems associated with it. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Mike. So 10 seconds each, and we close with you, Juan. Anya.
I think this is a great suggestion to have a session at the IGF on the GGE report next year. It reminds me on the WISIS session we had last year with formal input into official government process where everybody can contribute. It was still the governments who decided.
Izumi?
I totally agree. So start with more proactive information sharing and give room for others to make observations. And at the end, the state makes decision, but then have room for others to comment.
Marilia?
I completely agree with the session in the IGF. However, I know that it's very hard to bring the right security communities, the military people, to the IGF for different reasons. So maybe we should also go to them. And I think that the meeting point is a global conference on cyberspace. And we have the Global Forum on Cyber Expertise. We should reach out and try to organize something together. And thank you, Pablo, for the organization of the session. It has been very good and important.
To me, the suggestion on to look on operationalization of the norms was important, I think. But this shouldn't be done within the UNGG, but the UNGG should think on how to involve the technical community.
I think you may detect a theme. I think my takeaway for the GGE would be to think about what role the IGF and the IGF community could play in operationalizing the norms. You do not have states will have norms that will guide their behavior, but they don't have to be state-centric in operationalizing them entirely.
Like what Anya and Izumi said, I also support having a session at the IGF, and I would like to stress that we need to include other voices as well, including from those in the Global South and civil society. Thanks.
So this is in answer both to Matthew Shear's question and also as in terms of input to the GGE, and that's simply that in this process of operationalizing norms and in analyzing, developing, possibly critiquing norms at different layers, the different multi-stakeholder elements of the multi-stakeholder community, I think, are absolutely willing and showing in a lot of different ways, which we don't have time to go into, that they are willing and are actually acting towards that a very cooperative multi-stakeholder approach.
Juan, 10 seconds.
Yes. Before my final message, I want to address the technical participation. I can tell you that I agree, that we agree, and by the way, the expert that we selected for the GGE actually is one of the head of one of the Cuban CERTs. So he's a technical person that knows the issues, and we defend that linkage. My final message is that, as I told before, Cuba defends the idea that there's some linkage between the internet governance community and issues and the cybersecurity discussed there. To the extent of those linkages and the way that it can be operationalized, it has to be discussed and agree along the time. Even, as you know, I'm also part of the Working Group on Enhanced Cooperation, and there also, because I defend in this in both sides, I am also telling to the Working Group of Enhanced Cooperation that there's a linkage towards cybersecurity. So I believe that linkage exists. I don't know where to begin. I made a suggestion of terminology because I thought that was less controversial. I also mentioned the confidence building measure because I thought it's less controversial, and those two are definitely less controversial than NORD. But it's in the hand of what can be done, but I firmly believe that linkage exists.
With that, I think we need to close the session, and thank you very much to all that came here, and happy to continue the dialogue in the next opportunity. Shall we take a picture of all